I would like to ask you what you mean by that collaboration, integrated solutions. What is the key message that you're wanting to drive home, Ben? I'm going to start with you.
Okay. Thank you very much for the opportunity. the key message is the challenges that we are facing will need us to work together in terms of reaching new heights. And we believe that a collaborative effort will bring in new ideas, will co-create new knowledge, and will be able to go to new markets, clearly knowing that back at home as well, we're looking into the community, so it's not only about one person benefiting from that, it's about the community, the society, organizations, and everybody.
Simon, do you think this is happening right now?
It is happening. I think we can always do better and improve. The first thing we need to do is make sure that we understand the what we will call the interdependencies of Africa. Today, we see Africa is seen as the next frontier when it comes to global growth. And we see that for a lot of African entrepreneurs, if they're able to move beyond their borders, for example, South Africa work with Kenyan or Tanzanians, with Namibians, we think there are massive opportunities there. But it's not easier as one may think, because as we know, we have different cultural differences. And therefore, we strongly believe that we need to understand what we will call the Africa Entrepreneur Leadership Interdependencies.
What I want to ask you first, before you can even cross the border, you would have to be a successful business in yourself before you can even go to any other market or try to enter any other market. One of the things, before I came on the program, I was speaking to one of my colleagues who's from Kenya, you know, and as you know, we get so much news that comes from across the continent, and it seems to be the same thread, that one of the issues that entrepreneurs face, particularly a small business person, is that if they're doing business, say with government, say with other big business, the big issue comes into them not being paid, and them not being paid makes it difficult for them to operate. How do you overcome that?
How about if we actually look into this particular process in a different way and say non-payment and late payments can happen in whatever environment? That's number one. It may be, in this case, it's a matter of we've got a lot of new entrepreneurs coming in who might actually be struggling to actually make the point clear that our payment is clear within 30 days, then what do you do beyond 30 days? Because it's a process. Payment is a
What do you do as a small business person? What do you do if it's, say, from government, a big business that probably have more resources than you do? What do you do if that 30 days comes and you probably don't have the money to sue them, or whatever the case may be? Because what we're finding is that these businesses shut down because they don't have the resources to go after the people that pay them.
We've had a problem as well, where we couldn't be paid on time, dealing with some of those kind of projects that you actually mentioned. And what we had to do was to escalate the problem to a higher level within the organization. Each and every organization has got its own hierarchy. If you're talking about the municipalities, you've got to go to the highest level of the municipality in terms of the councillors. So that is the highest level. And I'm sure once you've actually reached that level where you can actually be able to get your answer, that's when that I would think, if it was me, I left to look for other options outside. But before that, it's one element of negotiations. And it's one element of the entrepreneurial spirit that has got to be within you in terms of how to push the boundaries where it's necessary. But I know it's not an easy process.
Simon, I want to come to you because he's talking about negotiations, and I think he also alluded to relationship and how important that is now in business. Business is about relationships now. It is about who you know and how you're able to negotiate those deals. So speak to us about the entrepreneur, especially when they're starting out and building that business, on how key it is for them to build those key relationships.
That's very important, because and that's the reason why we coined this as entrepreneurial leadership, because an entrepreneur and a leader is so difficult to sort of, let's say, separate the two, because the entrepreneurial leadership can be a competency that any CEO, executive, or mayor, or even the president of the country will need to have. But at the same time, for entrepreneurs, it is very important to use the leadership ability that are very much based on relationships, Trust me, if you're not going to work on relationships, you're not going to be able to mobilize resources, you're not going to be able to negotiate with people as it should be done. And we're seeing more and more entrepreneurs, especially here in Africa, they'll start with amazing ideas, but what sometimes prevent them from moving from where they are to where they need to be, it has to do with relationship, hence leadership. And I'll close it by saying that when we speak about entrepreneurial leadership, and that's why our campaign with African Entrepreneur is based on three things, direction, alignment, and commitment. So as an entrepreneurial leader, you need to make sure that whatever you do needs to have direction, alignment, and commitment. If you don't have that, all relationships you have, you may not be able to use on your own advantage.
What kind of the relationships are you supposed to be having? Because I think sometimes people get a little bit confused or don't know in terms of networking and what that actually means. So what are the relationships that, especially if you're starting or if you're still a very small business, who are the key people that you should be seeking out that are going to progress your business?
Let me go back a little bit to what we just discussed, which is actually going to relationships. Like as someone was saying, that the entrepreneurial leadership process is based on not only one person, but more than two people. And in this case, if you say, for example, you're talking about the supplier, or say you're talking about the client and the entrepreneur, it would mean that if it's a government or it's a municipality, the person who's within the municipality as an employee is an entrepreneurial leader. He's the one who's supposed to make it easy for the entrepreneur to be able to move forward. So the question is, what does he or she understand about the role that he's actually playing in terms of changing the landscape of South Africa as a whole or Africa as a whole? So that relationship then has got to start from there, where both of them will actually be able to understand what is it, what is the hope that we want to create for Africa. And once we can actually be able to understand that hope, you'll find that both of us will then move towards a better direction.
Oh man, yeah. I wanted to talk to you about financing and venture capital and how you do that. We've totally run out of time. It was such a crucial point, but I hope that you will be joining us again because that's really an important one, how you get the funding to continue to grow your business as a small entrepreneur. Thank you so much for joining us, gentlemen. That was Murari Manaka, founder of African Entrepreneur, and Simon Rweyongoza, he's regional director for Sub-Saharan Africa for the Center for Creative Leadership.